rose-colored glasses are off, it's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 8 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the high honor of interviewing none other than Mr. Jason Falls. Jason is the founder of Social Media Explorer, has a wealth of experience on both the brand and agency side of consulting. He is in demand on the speaking circuit and has spoke at, you name it, he's spoken there, and he's definitely one of the titans of the industry. Now, just as a heads up, I did have my 6-month-old son Oliver with me while I was recording this episode, and not to worry, he is a very well-behaved baby, but just so that you know, you might hear the odd coo or baby sound during the interview, but it did not diminish at all. So, without further ado, let's get into this awesome interview with none other than Mr. Jason Falls. Jason, thanks so much for taking the time to talk with me.
Great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Awesome. You were the opening keynote at the very first conference I ever attended, Digital Bootcamp in Cincinnati, Ohio. And I was about a year away from graduating Full Sail at the time. I was thinking about writing a book, thinking about, you know, hitting the whole speaking circuit. But just to see you get up on stage and rock the mic right, I can't tell you just what an impact that had on me. And I just, to even be talking to you right now, I'm fanboy freaking out just a little bit. So thank you just for being you.
Well, you're welcome. I'm it's always nice to hear stories like that, and it's kind of, I don't know, I'm kind of embarrassed but also a little humbled, so I'm glad I could be useful.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So the road to digital marketing tends to be a winding one. So tell us that story. When did you first get bit by the bug, and when did you first become enchanted with marketing?
Oof, yeah, you're right. It is a winding one. I think it all goes back to when I was in high school. I had a fascination with computers. And now this is back in the late 1980s, early 1990s. And there was a young man who was a couple of years younger than me who was the school computer geek. And he had all these computer games that he had written and so on and so forth. So I had him help me buy my first PC in 19, probably 90, I guess it was. And he showed me how to get onto bulletin boards and download little basic computer games. And I remember the first bulletin board I got on had a little IRC, a little chat room. It was very rudimentary, not even close to what chat rooms look like today. But I could communicate with people halfway around the world instantly, and it blew my mind. And from that point on, I was always fascinated with the internet, with computers, with, you know, how we could communicate on a more broad basis. I grew up in a very small town in eastern Kentucky, so being able to connect with people outside of this little, you know, sort of closed-minded world that I lived in was fascinating to me. And, you know, I went away to college. I worked at the radio station in high school. I went away to college, got a radio TV degree. I was very into broadcasting, television, radio, technology, and then sort of fell into a career in college athletics PR. So I was the stat guy and the guy who ran the press box and press row at basketball and football games for about 15 years for four different schools. And the whole time that I was doing that, I was trying to figure out ways to build better internet websites, better web pages, promote our student athletes and our coaches and our programs using the internet. And then when I got out of college athletics after my son was born, I was traveling too much and wanted to get into more mainstream marketing and PR. I landed at an advertising agency just at the right time. And had, you know, sort of some personal experience with blogs and social networks. And I kind of turned around and said to my bosses, why aren't we talking to our clients about blogging and social media and digital marketing more? And they said, well, we don't really know what you're talking about, but if you can sell it, you can do it. So go for it. And my bosses at the agency that I was at the time, which is an agency called Doe Anderson here in Louisville, they really empowered me. And it was the fact that they weren't afraid to let me, learn by trial and error and take ideas to clients that put me, you know, in a position to know a little something about digital marketing and work with clients on it. And that led to people wanting me to come speak at conferences, and that led to me writing a book and then writing another book. And so it just kind of snowballed. But I have to go back to the fact that I sat in on an internet relay chat room on an old monochrome PC monitor in 1990 and communicated in instant communication with someone halfway around the world. And that blew my mind, and that kind of got me hooked.
Awesome. That's amazing. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that shiny veneer kind of come off and you're like, okay, stuff just got real?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, I think it's a combination. For me, it was a combination of things. First of all, when I made the transition to mainstream advertising marketing PR in 2006, that was a real wake-up call for me, because I had been in college athletics, which is a very insulated industry, and I realized that there was this huge, big world of opportunity out there. But it was there were two disenchantment points for me. The first one was when I realized it doesn't matter how big the world is. It doesn't matter what the possibilities are. It's always going to be hard work to execute and get things done. You're always going to have to convince clients to spend the money. You're always going to have to convince them to take risks. So it's not, you know, just a world where you can wave your magic wand and introduce a client to something magical and they go, oh my goodness, here's a big fat check, let's go do it. It's a lot of work to get big projects and big ideas executed. So that was one. It was like, well, this isn't going to be easy, but that's certainly not something that discourages me. If you're afraid of hard work, then just hang it up, you know. But the second disenchantment point for me was I kind of fell victim, I think, to the whole social media celebrity kind of thing. You know, I was speaking at conferences. I wrote a couple of books. I started to become a circuit speaker, as it were. And that's a real ego soothing thing. When you go places and people want to hear you talk and they want to come up and talk to you afterwards, it makes you feel like a rock star to a certain degree. And I think for the first year or so, I kind of fell victim to that, and I let it get to my head a little bit. Which I don't like to do that. I'm you know, a small town kid. I don't like people who are pretentious. I didn't want to become that person. And so I think that I became disenchanted with the world of social media, the sort of industry insulated vertical of social media, probably a year or two into, you know, kind of having written a book and being out there speaking. And I realized that that it was really just an ego play. And so I started to kind of pull back from it a little bit. I still like to speak. I still like to be useful. I certainly do, you know, get a kick out of the fact that I walk into a conference in, you know, halfway across the country and people recognize me. That's very cool. But I try to almost immediately remind myself that I'm just here to share my knowledge. And if people know me as a result of that, that's great. But it doesn't mean I'm different. It doesn't mean I'm special. It doesn't mean I'm better. I'm just another person out here working at this. I just don't mind getting up on stage and talking about it.
Awesome. Thanks so much for sharing that vulnerability. So if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum. I live in a Doctor Who household, if you can't tell. And I just gave you a TARDIS. What is the top three things that you would tell your younger self to prepare for your career?
Wow, that is a great question. Well, the first thing I would do is I'd go back to about 1997 and tell my younger self to put all my money into Google stock. I think in order to prepare for my career, I think I would have gone back and told myself that, you know more than you think you know. Be confident in who you are and what you know, because I spent a lot of time and still spend a lot of time second guessing myself. And at the end of the day, you know, I'm smart enough, and I think most people are smart enough to have the right instincts and have the right gut feel And I think we have to we need to trust ourselves more. It's not just for me, it's for everybody. So I would say trust your instincts and know that you're smarter than you think you are. You don't have to second guess yourself nearly as much as you did along the way. I think the second thing that I would tell myself to prepare for my career is know that no matter what happens, no matter how good it gets, no matter how bad it gets, it's never as good as it seems. It's never as bad as it seems. And hard work is always the answer. If you're able to put your nose to the grindstone and work your butt off, you can get yourself out of any negative situation, and you can, you know, optimize and maximize and drag out the really good situations. You know, there's a lot of highs and lows in being an entrepreneur and being in business and you know, working in the digital marketing space, whether you're working with clients or whether you're just working on your own brand. But having more of an even keel approach to everything, I think, helps you, you know, weather the storms, as it were, and then also enjoy the good times that come along as a result of it. I think that's those are some pretty good ones. I think the definitely going back and telling myself to invest in Google stock in 1997 probably would have been a smart thing.
Absolutely. You and me both. I was like, I don't even know how old I was. I was probably 13, but I found some money to do that. So, yep. Yeah, absolutely. So awesome, man. That's great. We are going to take a short break. And then when we get back, we are going to jump into the nitty gritty about some of your experiences at conferences. So stay right with me. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry, this is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately, most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. And we're back. All right, Jason. So you, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss, or insert any other thought leader if you just happen to be at a different conference, you're all sitting at the bar after a conference and you're having a straight talk mini mastermind. And what would you say would be some of the things missing from the professional digital marketing space, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
My goodness, where in the hell are you getting these questions? Man, wow, that's a really good one. So what is missing from the digital marketing space, I think, I think the agency model is broken in a lot of ways. You know, there are lots of brands out there who do their digital marketing internally, but there are a lot more that rely on agencies and consultants and whatnot to handle their websites, handle their social, handle their paid social, so on and so forth. And unfortunately, over the course of the last, you know, probably 50 or 60 years, and it bleeds over into advertising and PR as well, not just digital, we've created a culture where brands basically dangle a carrot out there for agencies and say, we're going to pay you money and you get the prestige of working with us, but you're going to have to jump through a lot of hoops, do exactly what we say, never tell us no, always be on call, completely throw away your work-life balance, ignore your family, ignore your kids, because we own you. And I've been at several different agencies and I've worked at a couple of brands, and that has almost always been sort of the mantra. And I think that's broken because I think we've created a culture where if you're at an agency, You're expected to always be on call. You're expected to always say yes. And I think it should be a different dynamic. I think the agency should be a true partner with the brand they're working with, and where there's mutual respect on both sides of the aisle, and where the agency is expected to push back and expected to do what's best for the brand, and work together to solve problems, as opposed to the brand says jump and you say how high. Unfortunately, though, there are so many agencies out there that are willing to bend over backwards to get that relationship with the brand, and brands know this. They say, well, if this agency doesn't do exactly what I want them to do, or, you know, perform and deliver the metrics that I want them to deliver, then I'll just go to another agency. It's easy for me to switch and find someone else who I can abuse for 18 months and then switch and abuse somebody else. So I think that model in digital marketing is broken right now. And I think if we could find a way to fix it, and make it so that brands valued and respected both the ideas and the work and the energy and the personalities and the humanity of the agencies they work with, the agencies would do better work, the brands would get a better return, and everybody in the scenario would be happy. I've become, if you want to talk about disenchantment, I've become very disenchanted with being on the agency side of things, because you basically are subjecting yourself to varying degrees of abuse from CMOs and brand managers who just want to take advantage of the fact that, hey, we signed up for this retainer and that means I own you. And I don't care for that all that much. So I've stepped away from it to a degree. I still do consulting work, but I'm very choosy on who I work with, because I want to work with people who value me and value the work that I do, as opposed to just seeing me as, a worker bee who's going to, say how high when you say jump.
I love that. I absolutely love that. And I could not agree more. Myself and my co-author, we run a small digital marketing agency, Digital Marketing Advisors. And we haven't had too many horror stories, but we have had a couple. And so, that's part and parcel of just running an agency. And I think young professionals definitely need to know that. So one last question, and we'll let you get back to your day. And I really appreciate your time. And it's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast. But I do want to take a moment just sort of set it up and set the stage for it, because in my personal opinion, and you might think differently, but there's a gap in the professional digital marketing education space with regards to career trajectory. Mm-hmm. And by professional, I mean someone who works in-house at a corporation or a brand or works at an agency. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship or solopreneurs or anything like that, even though you could absolutely make the case that somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas are professionals because they operate at such a high level. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, like people who get a W-2 at the end of the year. So what ends up happening for a lot of folks, just using my own journey as an analog, is that you sort of meander the interwebs of Google for a while, but there's no guarantees there. You might land on lynda.com, Udemy, or Marketing Profs, or you might wind up doing Mary Kay in Legal Shield. Like, who knows, right? That can sort of shake out anyway. So what happens is that you meander the wilderness for a year or 10 or however long, and at some point you get serious, and at that point you kind of have two options. You can do what I did, which is go back to school and get a degree in internet marketing. However, the cons to that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to do that. Plus, it's time consuming, because even though full sales degree program is accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And 30 months in the digital marketing space is an eternity. A lot can change in that time.
Right.
So how most people educate themselves is via conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that it can be very expensive, because most of your top tier conferences, like a MozCon or inbound.org summit or something like that, they're going to be anywhere from $500 to $1,500 just to get through the door.
Yep.
That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, food, Uber. None of that. Just to have your face in that place, $500 to $1,500. After you add all those things back in, you're looking at anywhere between $3,000 and $5,000 on a weekend.
Right.
And then a lot of times there may be an upsell from the stage for an educational product or a mastermind or something like that. And those can be in excess of like $10,000. So even though in aggregate it's a lot cheaper and faster than going to school, you gotta have that money up front, because Russell Brunson from a ClickFunnels, he doesn't take financial aid, right? You gotta have Russell's money or you're out. So there's gotta be something else. There's gotta be another way besides just either rolling the dice on Google, going to school and having to sell your firstborn child to the U.S. Department of Education or going to a conference. So that's right. Now that I've rambled for a few minutes, that's, setting the stage for this last question, which is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skills, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke. You have somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Again, who in the hell writes these questions? I know you do, but my God, these are great. Okay, 30 days. I think what I would do is exactly what I did when I started out. I got a job at an advertising agency. I knew that I needed to connect with the thought leaders in the space, in the social media, digital marketing, PR space. And so I started commenting on their blog. I started sharing their content. I signed up for all the social media accounts. I'd already signed up for them, but I started using my social media accounts to amplify the content of smart people. And so, back in my day, that was folks like Todd Defrin and Constantine Basturia and Jeremy Pepper. And it was a very PR heavy set of people that I was sharing content of back then. But there were people like Chris Brogan and Jeremiah Aoyang that were in that set. And I just started to interact with them and then also create my own content that they would then see, because they're like, well, who is this guy from Kentucky who keeps, commenting on my stuff and sharing my content? Let's go see if he knows what he's doing. And once I got my content in front of them, they realized, hey, this guy's smart. He knows what he's talking about. So they started sharing my content. Now, all of a sudden, I'm building my network. I'm building my own audience. And over time, I'm able to monetize that. Now, am I able to monetize that in 30 days? Probably not. So if I were to do that, I think I would probably reach out to, the thought leaders in the business and or brands that are out there that I know have content teams and say, I'm smart, I'm capable, and I'm ready to write content or manage your blog or, do whatever it is you need done at a high level. So that I can, make some revenue, turn some income, and then over time, build that audience of my own so that I can create that revenue for myself and not for somebody else. But that's, in essence, that's kind of what I did. I mean, I had a paying job, I had my food and all that covered. I wanted to build a name for myself in the digital marketing space. And so I reached out to the thought leaders in the industry. I commented on their blogs. I shared their content. I did have the good fortune of being able to afford to go to a couple of conferences. My business sent me. Went to a couple conferences, networked with them in person, and that certainly helps ramp up the speed with which you can be successful in the space. But it really is about building relationships, making yourself known to those people, and then following that up with the meat of it all, which is that you also have good ideas to share too.
Jason, I love these answers. You're talking about the questions, like these answers are stupendous. I'm just starting a podcast, so I don't have like a top list yet, but I can almost assure you you're going to be on it. So where can we get some more of you? Like, where can we follow you on Twitter? Tell us about Conversation Research Institute and, how to get more of your awesomeness.
Sure. Sure. So there's a couple places to find me online. First of all, I'm Jason Falls on just about every social network, so I'm easy to find. JasonFalls.com is my sort of core blog. I've started to really focus the content there on helping small and medium businesses, which is something that I've wanted to do for a long time, but for my own sort of selfish purposes for my career in the agency life and whatnot, I've been focused on medium to large, but now I'm starting to turn my attentions to helping the SMB market quite a bit more, and I hope to be launching some workshops in 2017 that will actually get in front of people and help small businesses sort of get with the program, the ones that aren't already. So jasonfalls.com is a great place for that. Conversation Research Institute is at conversationresearchinstitute.com. That is my business, and we are focused on mining online conversations for consumer insights. So this is a play for medium to large brands who want to do market research and understand their customers better, but don't want to go spend $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 on national surveys or focus groups or traditional research. We don't say that we're a replacement for traditional research. We're more of a supplement to it. But there are lots of fascinating things you can find out about your consumers, lots of issues that you can track and manage if you're using conversation research to sort of pull insights out to help your business or brand make better marketing decisions. So that's the day job. That's the full-time thing that I'm really devoted to. And then on the side at jasonfalls.com, I'm really focused on helping small businesses, and hopefully we'll be developing the content there into much more than just a blog over the course of the next year.
Awesome. Well, you heard it there, folks. JasonFalls.com, Jason Falls on all social media. If you got the money, definitely check out Conversation Research Institute. And Jason, this has been the highlight so far of my 2016, and I'm not kidding. I've been a fan for a very long time. Thank you so much for your time.
Well, I'm honored to be here, and I expect there will be nothing but big things to come for you, because you're doing it right, and you're working hard, and that's what it takes.
Appreciate it, man. Jason, thanks. Have you ever been paralyzed while doing research? You go to Google, you type in your search query, and seconds later, you're hit with millions, if not billions, of search results, and you can't make heads or tails out of any of them. Overwhelmed and afraid you'll make the wrong choice, you don't make any choice at all. Well, friends, you're not alone, but you needn't suffer in silence. The ability to make sense out of what you find online, and more importantly, call BS when you see it, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as what I've learned getting a degree in internet marketing, for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. One more time, bit.ly.com/DMD course. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.